So we're recording. We're going to begin with this interactive session. So first of all, welcome to this interactive session titled Ionos Cloud, the European Cloud Alternative. And thanks for joining. My name is Alexander Nyaho. I'm an account manager at Ionos Cloud based in Berlin and responsible for business development in the northeast corner of Germany, from Berlin up to Rostock and back down to Leipzig. And I'm joined here by my colleague from the professional service, Ben Schmidt, who's going to give himself or introduce himself briefly.
Yeah, thanks, Alexander. Yeah, Benjamin Schmidt, my name. I'm a cloud solution architect in the professional service team of IONOS. I've been with the company for over 4 years now, and I was also involved in the Kubernetes project. We started that about 3.5 years ago, deciding if we should build on one of the existing tools or if we should do our own development. We decided to go our own way, and we've been on the market for a couple of years now. So yeah, we can basically also say that the service itself is stable, and we want to provide an overview of the company and specifically of the managed Kubernetes offering, of course, today.
Yeah, that's quite right. So, thanks for the introduction. I think I've also been with the company since summer this year, so a relatively new hire. But the team in itself has tripled in the last 12 months, and we're seeing a phase of hyper growth within the company at the moment. Not only the number of headcount, but also the number of new products and features that are coming online every month. And so the aim of the talk today is to give a little bit more background into the Ionos Cloud, who we are and where we came from, for those who perhaps aren't aware. There's already been several talks this morning about the Ionos Cloud and some of the projects we've been involved in. For example, the HPI Shul Cloud, which is a project where we brought on over 1.5 million users, over 4,000 schools, within just 2 months, based on the Kubernetes platform. But during those talks, there wasn't much stuff into who is the Ionos Cloud. So we're going to take advantage of that today. This is called an interactive session, but one thing that's lacking that would have on premise or at the conference itself would be to see some raised hands to understand who is familiar in what ways with the company. For me in particular, it would be interesting to know who knows the difference between Ionos and Ionos Cloud, which are two subdivisions within the company. Who is already using the Ionos Cloud and for what use cases rather, and finally to know who's already using the managed Kubernetes service. Because of course we don't have we're not on site today, unfortunately we can't do that, so we're just going to crack straight on with a short overview of the company, where we came from and where we're going. So the Ionos Cloud is one of two subdivisions of Ionos SE. So to start at the beginning, Ionos SE is part of 1&1, or the 1&1 telecommunications company, which was started in 1988, and over the years grew to be the European market leader in hosting. So is the leading European hosting provider, with over 12 million managed domains, over 13 data centers, over 8 million customers, and well, a lot of servers as well. A huge amount of infrastructure, but also as a German company, growing up, meeting the requirements of German and European data center laws, which is something that's become extremely important in recent years. So we already had the infrastructure and the capacity as the leader in hosting. And that made it very easy for us to take the next step, which followed in 2018 with the merger with ProfitBricks, which was a Berlin public cloud startup, to build an enterprise cloud. And so Ionos Cloud was born. And the Ionos Cloud is to fill the whole of European hyperscalers. As we know, in the market, there's various Asian as well as US providers, but not many European providers. So this is where we fit in into the group. For anyone who's, for the non-German spectators of this talk, every German will know 1&1. It's a household name. A lot of the people will have their mobile phone contracts, for example, on 1&1, or also their home Wi-Fi. So we're working a lot in the consumer space. Ionos itself, though, however, is more well known for domains, as well as bare metal services, for instance, and hosting. Also catering in part to the consumers in that case, but also to small businesses. And the Ionos Cloud has its clear focus on the enterprise and fulfilling the requirements of European enterprises. European, actually globally based, on the right-hand side, you'll see a number of other well-known companies over Europe. So Strato and Internet X are based in Germany, providing domains as well as bare metal services. Arsys is in France, Farsys is in the UK, and HomePL, of course, in Poland. So well stretched out over Europe with our data center presence. And as the Ionos Enterprise Cloud, we're also a Gaia X founding member and are very much committed to this European EU-wide project of building an ecosystem of solution providers and software providers to be able to build and to make accessible all of those features that are today readily over various cloud providers, but without the cloud lock-in that inevitably comes with using those cloud providers. Another reason for why the company was born is around data sovereignty and data privacy issues. I think GDPR is something that everyone has had to get used to over the last, should we say, 5 or 6 years, maybe plus. Anyone who follows Max Schrems, who's a lobbyist lobbying the EU Parliament regarding data sovereignty and mass surveillance of EU citizens, they will know that he was able to convince the EU Parliament to overthrow the Privacy Shield ruling, so the agreement between the EU and the US on data sovereignty, in the last year or two. And currently, there are large concerns in the EU, in Europe, about data privacy, data sovereignty, and really what's happening with our data. So this is a core issue that Ionos Cloud is addressing, and it's a reason for the being of the company. So we decided to build the Ionos Enterprise Cloud to address the gap in the European market. And of course, once you've addressed the initial concerns of security and compliance, of course, extremely important, the next important step is to look into cloud performance. So what we did upon building the platform was to invite in a third party company here, Cloud Spectator, to take a look at our platform, have a look under the bonnet, and to test the performance, test the benchmarking, carry out some benchmarking tests to test the performance of the platform itself. This, we then got a, I think, 40 plus page document on the performance. And I would urge anyone watching this to go over to our website and download the report, not only to see how Ionos is performing, but also to see how the market is performing overall. There's some very interesting benchmark tests which were done there. And you can get access to that document immediately and have a read through it. Ben is going to copy the link in the chat, which may not come out well on the recording, but you'll have our details afterwards should you want to access that report. And in particular, in the report, there were three areas where Ionos performed particularly well, and that was in the block storage performance, both read and write, also in the multi-core compute performance, and was the best performer in the price-to-performance ratio. But we would also suggest, not just to take our word for it, we're quite happy to offer a 30-day trial period for free. Should you care to log on yourself, go onto the platform, and run your own benchmarking tests to see if you agree with the Cloud Spectator and can back up their results. Ben, were you able to share the link? Yeah, okay.
Yep, it's in the chat.
Okay, great. So we spoke a little bit about why we exist, why the Ionos Cloud exists, and the necessity that we see in the market right now. And so I'd also like to talk a little bit about why are companies choosing to join us and why are they staying with the Ionos Cloud right now. We built our offer around five core principles: performance, security, ease of use, fairness, and customer orientation. And I'm just going to talk about one point of each of these core principles. So performance, I think I already covered it to a certain extent by talking about the third-party review. One thing that we do to ensure that performance and guaranteed performance is by no overbooking on the platform. So everything that you use, you're using dedicated resources that ensures the optimum performance of your application. Regarding security, of course, we're firmly grounded as a European company, as a German company, data privacy. So security is of utmost importance, and we can offer, or we can guarantee, even maximal security against the US Cloud Act and surveillance measures taken as part of that, which is what that's designed to provide, or what Privacy Shield was also designed to block. Regarding ease of use, those of you who know a little bit of Ionos Cloud will know the very famous user interface, the Data Center Designer, which is based on drag and drop to create your virtual data centers to design and then deploy. Very easy to use interface, but we also put the clear focus on building in automation to everything we do, using API calls or making APIs available so that you can build your infrastructure with the utmost automation and have a fluid functioning platform. As far as fairness is concerned, there's no contractual commitment whatsoever with the Ionos Cloud. You can start this morning and cancel later this afternoon should you want to. There's no minimum fee whatsoever. So in that case, it is really pure cloud in the sense of you're paying what you're using for with no vendor lock-in. On top of that, the managed Kubernetes service is offered as a free feature on top of that. As a European company, I think customer orientation is extremely important for us. We see ourselves as a business partner for the companies we work with, directly contactable, whether it be for general queries, also for support queries. I think cloud is becoming, if not for most companies already, is becoming really business critical part of the company to have a functioning cloud. And therefore, you need to have your business partners always on hand, always available. And that is one of our core principles also. So moving on to the product portfolio, we base the platform on two platforms, in fact. We have our public cloud platform as well as the private cloud platform. Both of these are protected by our DDoS advanced services DDoS defense mechanism. On the public cloud, we have, of course, our, as is usual, infrastructure as a service compute engine for your computing power needs. As far as storage offerings are concerned, we have various next to block storage. We also offer our S3 ready object storage, obviously using the advantages of the cloud for your storage to scale up and down, only pay what you need for long-term protection, and also that the S3 object storage gives you the opportunity to create your own backup solutions as well, should you want to. Managed services that we offer on top today, these are always being refreshed, always new coming. Today we're going to talk a bit more about the managed Kubernetes service that we provide. Next to that, we also offer a number of various managed databases, and of course also a managed backup as a service. Various network services that we're offering listed here. I have DDoS Protect, managed load balancer, also a managed NATGET gateway, as mentioned before. As a company in a high growth phase, we have a lot of product innovation at the moment and a lot of new products coming to the line every single month. On the private cloud platform, we are offering a single tenant, dedicated, physically separated environment. The hardware is dedicated to your company. However, you only pay for the underlying core nodes, and anything above that, you're able to take advantage of pay-as-you-go services and to scale your costs up and down accordingly with only a very small minimum monthly cost. And the private cloud is based on VMware vSphere. So most people in this call are already well familiar with VMware vSphere. I don't need to talk, I don't think, about the individual features that are available on the platform, but you're able to use all of those features on the platform, but with the added benefit of using the pay-as-you-go cost structure, perhaps saving yourself costs for storing disks on site and backups and maintenance contracts and the whole rest of it. And what we try to do with this, with our overall product portfolio, is to provide a complete solution for all companies at any stage in their cloud journey. So if today you're only on-premise and want to immediately get into the cloud, probably you're using VMware already, and the vSphere private cloud solution allows you to do a very quick migration, migrating those applications one-to-one into the cloud without having too much of tinkering required for the individual applications. And likewise, for companies who are already more advanced in their cloud journey, we would recommend, of course, the public cloud, where you're already able to build your cloud native applications and to scale further into the cloud. But without further ado, I will hand over now to Ben to talk a little bit about the managed Kubernetes solution.
Yeah, thanks, Alexander, for providing such an overview about IONOS as a company, but also a high-level overview about our services that we're offering. Of course, the topic today is Kubernetes. We are offering a managed Kubernetes, so the service itself is fully managed by us. And this includes the control plane, which is managed by us, but also the worker nodes, which are fully managed by us. And the size of the nodes and the number of nodes is something that the user can decide upon when creating the clusters. So that is fully customizable. At the moment, the clusters itself are public clusters. That means the control plane, as well as any of the worker nodes, they have an interface in the internet, a public IP address. But we are also, in the meantime, working on private node pools, a feature which will create nodes and node pools not located in the internet, but inside of the private network, inside of a user's virtual data center, inside the IONOS compute engine. And that's a feature that we will most likely launch next month then. The Kubernetes nodes itself are normal standard VMs that you can run inside of your virtual machine, inside of the compute engine, and they are dedicated to your cluster. And also the control plane, of course, is a dedicated control plane dedicated to your particular cluster. Everything is built on and with automation. That means from the moment you deploy the cluster and your node pools until you can actually connect to the Kubernetes API, it will only take you a couple of minutes. When creating a new cluster, you have the option to choose from the latest three Kubernetes versions that we are offering. And actually, we're following the Cloud Native Foundation in this regard. Our most current release is the 1.21.4. And as I mentioned, the three most current ones, so you will also have available the 1.19, 1.20, and the 1.22. We always take a couple of weeks until we have the newest Kubernetes version tested and ready on our platform. So in a couple of weeks, you will see the 1.22 available as well. And with that, basically, we end the support of the 1.19, so to be in line with the Cloud Native Foundation again. Updating a cluster is actually just as easy as creating a cluster. So as I mentioned, as soon as a new version is available there, you will see it either inside of the portal, or also there is an API call, of course, to fetch the newest updates. And any updates that we're performing, whether this is the control plane or any of the worker nodes or node pools, this is always done in a rolling update mechanism. So the customer can decide for a certain time when this should be updated. And the rolling update strategy makes sure that this is actually done with zero downtime. So what we do, for example, for the node pool is we create a new node, we attach it to the node pool. Then one of the old nodes, we will cordon and we drain it, make sure that it's empty. And once it's empty, we simply delete that node. And this is how we're going through a circle with all available nodes until they all have the most current version. So assuming you're running replicas and you have your pod disruption budgets in place, as you actually should, as is best practice, then an update of the cluster or an update of the node pools of any of the nodes is fully transparent and it involves zero downtime for your services. But it's not only the Kubernetes services or versions that we're taking care of, but we're also taking care of maintenance of the operating system. They have a life cycle. We are also implementing and taking care of some of the other components that is needed to run a Kubernetes cluster inside of a cloud provider. For example, the Cloud Control Manager or our CSI-based storage classes to support dynamic volume provisioning, or for example, Core DNS connectivity. Any such implementations have a life cycle and need to be updated sooner or later. And this is actually being done inside of a maintenance window. It's a weekly maintenance window that the user sets for his particular cluster. Let's say, for example, Sunday evening at 9 p.m. And during this time frame, these kinds of components would be updated. Again, fully automated and causing no downtime. Part of automation is, of course, also the ability to scale. Of course, our clusters support the normal horizontal pod autoscaling. And in addition to that, we're also deploying and installing the cluster autoscaler. That means this will enable a horizontal node pool autoscaling, creating actually a fully breathing cluster. It is Kubernetes itself who decides when to add another node, so it will upscale. But it will also see if it can downscale, if the containers running inside of your cluster can be consolidated, and if one node can be thrown away for cost optimization, then the cluster autoscaler will do so. The Kubernetes itself is also fully integrated in our existing portfolio. It is based on the compute engine, and it's actually reusing the same kinds of technologies that we are using there. For example, the storage stack. So I already mentioned we are supporting a CSI-based dynamic volume provisioning. So as a user of the cloud or of the Kubernetes cluster, all I need to do is create a persistent volume claim. through the CSI-based storage class, out of the persistent volume claim, automatically a persistent volume is created. And this is, as I mentioned, based on the existing storage stack. We are supporting HDD and SSD storage types. And with the SSDs, we're also providing guaranteed IOPS and guaranteed bandwidth. By now, we also have two performance classes for SSDs. So it's a low-cost option you have and our premium stack. So for both of these storage classes, also volume expansion is supported. So in case you would need to increase your volumes, you can do so. And automatically, the block volume is increased as well. Sorry about that. What we also have integrated is into our private networks. As I mentioned, the clusters itself, they are public clusters with a public interface. But in addition to that, you might want to integrate services that you do not have running inside of your Kubernetes cluster. Let's say, for example, a database. For certain reasons, you might not want to put it in the database. Technologically, it might not work out. So you can run that alongside the cluster inside the same virtual data center in a standard virtual machine. And they are connected, interconnected through a private network. It is also integrated into our data center designer. This is the web application where you manage not only individual machines, but full virtual data centers, including virtual machines, software-defined networking stack, the storage stack I mentioned, backup, S3 object storage. So all of that is combined under a nice graphical interface, our web application, the data center designer. And it itself is based on our cloud API. It's a REST-based API that you can, of course, use natively, also to provision your clusters. But in addition to that, we also provide modules and plugins to the most common DevOps tools, something like Terraform or Ansible. Also, with these kinds of tools, you will be able to provision your clusters, again, in a fully automated way, as this is the cloud-native way of how to deploy not only clusters, but also your services. And in addition to that, we also provide a enterprise-grade support. This is available over a hotline or via email, of course, in German and English. And it is qualified Linux admins that you will be speaking to. They are trained with our platform, of course. Some of them are also Kubernetes certified. So also on a Kubernetes level, you will be speaking eye to eye with people that understand your problems and will be able to help you quickly. So this was a quick overview of what we are doing with Kubernetes and how our clusters are managed. Do we have some questions? Let's maybe focus on that. I think you're still muted, Alexander.
Thank you. We have about 3 or 4 minutes until the end of the session. So yeah, perhaps we can wait to see if any questions come in. I can't see any at the moment. So to get us started, I have a question. And would be interested to know what type of services can we expose in the Ionis Kubernetes?
Yeah, basically any native Kubernetes service you will be able to expose. So Kubernetes has, let's say, three main types of services. One of them is called cluster IP. This exposes your services within the cluster. Of course, this is supported. The second way is node pools, a service of type node pool. This is also supported. This will expose your service to the outside world on a high port of the node. And then the third one, this is the most exciting one, of course, this is the type load balancer. And also this is supported. So you will receive automatically a static IP address, which is reserved for your service. And it is attached to the nodes. So thereby you can reach your services also by this dedicated IP address. This is the one that you would also put into the DNS server, of course, to reach your service via a name.
Okay, great. I'm still waiting for other questions to come in, so.
Go ahead with your own, that's fine.
Yeah, in the meantime, what about an ingress controller? Is there a controller integrated in the platform, or how do we manage that?
At the moment, there is no pre-installed ingress controller. We encourage our customers to go the cloud native way. There are many great projects out there, whether this is an Nginx ingress controller or traffic or anything else. It will work on our platform. We are deploying a native Kubernetes cluster, staying to the version of the Cloud Native Foundation as strictly as possible. So you can assume that, well, I would say like 99% of the projects and examples you find out on the internet, they will run out of the box on our platform as well.
Okay, great. And how about if I'm, depending on where I am with my Kubernetes journey, perhaps I've built my own stack on bare metal, or perhaps on premise, or already have an existing Kubernetes running on a different platform. Do I have to keep in mind if I want to migrate my existing stack onto the Ionis managed Kubernetes platform?
Yes, Kubernetes itself makes it very easy to migrate from on-premise to any cloud provider or between any cloud provider. It's a standard Kubernetes version that we are deploying, as I mentioned. So your manifests, they will work on your on-premise cluster as they will just on an Ionis managed Kubernetes cluster. That is no problem at all. And in addition, due to our focus on automation and the integration of DevOps tools, actually with industry standards more or less, it is also very easy to do this initial step of provisioning a Kubernetes cluster. So we are providing for example, the Terraform resources, and with a short script, you will have your fully automated Kubernetes cluster set up via Terraform. So you're reusing the same tools. You're using Terraform for your on-premise environment, and you can reuse the same tool for deploying a cluster at Ionis. Same thing for Ansible. We have a full Ansible integration, not only for Kubernetes, but of course, to provision also normal standard VMs just as well.
And it's as easy as that.
It is.
Sounds great. I'm sure there's some finer details that we could easily dive into, but I see our time is up. But I've shared our contact details on the slide. So anyone viewing is free to get in contact with us directly to perhaps pitch some more specific questions. I speak for myself, but hopefully for you also, I'm happy to field any questions regarding this topic.
Great. Thank you also from my side, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you, you too. I'm going to go ahead and